جود مورنينج، ذيس از دكتور عادل بندق، بروفيسور اوف اناتومي اند نيورو ساينس، منصوره يونيفرستي ايجيبت. توداي اي ويل توك اباوت ذا ميديا ستاينم. وات شود يو نو اباوت ذا ميديا ستاينم؟ فيرست ذا ديفينيشن. ذا ميديا ستاينم از ذا سبيس بتوين ذا تو بلورال كافيتيز اور ذا سبيس بتوين ذا تو لانجز. ذن ويل توك اباوت ذا ديفيجنز اوف ذا ميديا ستاينم. ات از ديفايدد باي ذا بلين of the sternal angle, or it is divided by a line extending from the sternal angle to the lower border of T4 vertebra into superior mediastinum above and inferior mediastinum below. And this inferior mediastinum is divided by the heart into three parts: anterior mediastinum, anterior to the heart, middle mediastinum containing the heart and the big vessels, and the posterior mediastinum behind the heart. Again, the mediastinum is divided by the plane of the sternal angle or by the line extending from the sternal angle to the lower border of T4 into superior mediastinum and inferior mediastinum. Superior mediastinum above, inferior mediastinum below, and the inferior mediastinum is divided by the heart into three parts: anterior mediastinum in front, middle mediastinum containing the heart and the pericardium, posterior mediastinum behind the heart. Now let us talk about the superior mediastinum. We'll start by the boundaries and then the contents. Boundaries of the superior mediastinum: anterior boundary is the manubrium of the sternum, posterior boundary is the upper four thoracic vertebrae, superior boundary is the thoracic inlet or the line extending from the suprasternal notch to the upper border of T1. The inferior border is the level of the sternal angle extending from the sternal angle to the lower border of T4. Then the contents of the superior mediastinum. Superior mediastinum contains many structures. Let us put the landmark of the superior mediastinum, and this is the plane of the sternal angle. So above the plane of the sternal angle, we have several structures. Number one, four arteries. What are the four arteries? This is the arch of the aorta, or aortic arch, giving three branches. The three branches: brachiocephalic artery, left common carotid artery, and the left subclavian artery. Then four veins. The four veins are left brachiocephalic vein, crossing the mediastinum, and right brachiocephalic vein. The two veins join to form the superior vena cava. Actually, the superior vena cava, the upper part is in the superior mediastinum, the lower part is in the middle mediastinum. So the three veins now: left brachiocephalic vein, right brachiocephalic vein, upper part of the superior vena cava, and the left superior intercostal vein. Then we have four nerves. The four nerves: two phrenic nerves and two vagus nerves, okay, on each side, and then cardiac branches to the superficial cardiac plexus, or cardiac branches to the cardiac plexus, and the left recurrent laryngeal nerve. So the four nerves again: phrenic nerves, vagus nerves, cardiac branches to the cardiac plexus, and the left recurrent laryngeal nerve. Then three viscera: trachea, esophagus, and upper part of the thymus gland. And three muscles: two muscles attached to the manubrium, sternohyoid and sternothyroid, and one muscle in front of the vertebra, prevertebral muscles or longus coli, and lymph nodes and the thoracic duct. This is the thoracic duct. Again, contents of the superior mediastinum: four arteries, aortic arch, left brachiocephalic artery, aortic arch, brachiocephalic artery, it is only one brachiocephalic artery, and then left common carotid artery and the left subclavian artery. Four veins: left brachiocephalic vein, right brachiocephalic vein, upper part of superior vena cava, and the left superior intercostal vein. Four nerves: phrenic nerves, vagus nerves, left recurrent laryngeal nerve, and the cardiac branches to the cardiac plexus. Three viscera: trachea, esophagus, and upper part of the thymus gland. Three muscles: sternohyoid, sternothyroid, and longus coli muscle, or prevertebral muscle, and then lymph nodes and thoracic duct. Then the inferior mediastinum. Inferior mediastinum is the mediastinum below the level of the sternal angle. It is divided by the heart into three parts. Anterior mediastinum, anterior to the heart. Middle mediastinum, containing the heart. Posterior mediastinum, behind the heart. So this is the inferior mediastinum. Okay. Anterior mediastinum in front of the heart. Middle mediastinum is the heart and the big vessels. Posterior mediastinum between the heart and the vertebrae. Let us talk about the anterior mediastinum. Anterior mediastinum is the mediastinum in front of the heart, or actually between the heart and the body of the sternum. It contains lower part of the thymus gland. Okay, this is the lower part of the thymus gland. The upper part is in the superior mediastinum, and these ligaments between the body of the sternum and the pericardium, upper and lower sternopericardial ligaments. So the anterior mediastinum between the heart and the body of the sternum, it contains lower part of the thymus gland and the sternopericardial ligaments, upper and lower. Then the middle mediastinum. This is the middle mediastinum. It contains the heart and the pericardium. Heart and the pericardium. It contains the two the big vessels, big arteries and big veins. Two big arteries. Ascending aorta and the pulmonary trunk. And two big veins. Lower part of the superior vena cava. Inferior vena cava, upper part of inferior vena cava, and the four pulmonary veins. You don't see the pulmonary veins because they are located behind the heart. Okay? And the two phrenic nerves. This is one, this is the other one. And actually, this is a major bronchi. Okay? Major bronchi, two main bronchi. And these lymph nodes, bronchopulmonary lymph nodes, and the tracheobronchial lymph nodes. Again, the middle mediastinum. This is the middle mediastinum. It contains heart and the pericardium. It contains two big arteries, ascending aorta and the pulmonary trunk. It contains three veins, lower part of superior vena cava, upper part of inferior vena cava, and four pulmonary veins behind the heart, entering the left atrium, and two phrenic nerves, and two main bronchi, and lymph nodes. Bronchopulmonary lymph nodes at the hilum of the lung and the tracheobronchial lymph nodes. Then the posterior mediastinum. This is the posterior mediastinum behind the heart. Let us talk first about the boundaries. Okay. Superior boundary, it is the line of the sternal angle. Inferior boundary is the diaphragm. Okay, anterior boundary is the heart and the pericardium. And the posterior boundary is the lower eight thoracic vertebrae. So the boundaries of the posterior mediastinum. Superiorly, it is the line of the sternal angle. Inferiorly, it is the diaphragm. Anteriorly, it is the heart and the pericardium. Posteriorly, lower eight thoracic vertebrae. Now the contents. Contents of the posterior mediastinum. The most anterior content is the esophagus. This is the esophagus. And this esophagus is surrounded by esophageal plexus. Esophageal plexus is formed by the vagus nerves. And then three tubes. Descending the aorta. Thoracic duct and azygous vein. Azygous vein, and two hemiazygous veins joining the azygous vein opposite T8. Thoracic duct, and this thoracic duct deviates from right to left at the level of T5. Sympathetic trunks, and the mediastinal lymph nodes. Again, the posterior mediastinum contains. The most anterior structure is the esophagus, surrounded by esophageal plexus formed by the two vagus nerves. Then, thoracic duct, azygous vein, two hemiazygous veins entering the azygous vein. Okay, symphatic trunks and the mediastinal lymph nodes. Again, esophagus. Behind and surrounded by esophageal plexus. Behind the esophagus, descending thoracic aorta, thoracic duct, azygous vein. Two hemiazygous veins entering the azygous vein opposite T8 and mediastinal lymph nodes. Now let us talk about some structures in the mediastinum. Start by the phrenic nerve. What should you know about the phrenic nerve? Okay, origin. It arises from C3, 4, and 5 in the neck. It arises in the neck. The root value is C3, 4, and C5. Then the course. Course in the neck and in the thorax. In the neck, it lies in front of the scalenus anterior muscle. This is the landmark in the neck. Anterior to the scalenus anterior. In the thorax, the right phrenic nerve takes the venous side, is on the right side of right brachiocephalic vein, on the right side of the superior vena cava, on the right side of the right atrium, on the right side of the inferior vena cava. The left phrenic nerve takes the arterial side between the left common carotid and left subclavian artery, on the left side of the heart and the pericardium, left ventricle. Okay, so the course of the phrenic nerve in the neck in front of the scalenus anterior. In the thorax, it runs in the superior mediastinum and the middle mediastinum. The right phrenic nerve takes the venous side, the left phrenic nerve takes the arterial side. Then we'll talk about the distribution of the phrenic nerve. This is the phrenic nerve, phrenic nerve, phrenic nerve, okay. Motor distribution and sensory distribution. Motor distribution, of course, to the diaphragm. Sensory distribution. Distribution in the thorax and the distribution in the abdomen. In the thorax and the abdomen. In the thorax, it supplies the mediastinal and the diaphragmatic pleura. Parietal pleura, of course. It supplies the pericardium, okay? It supplies the mediastinal and the diaphragmatic pleura, and it gives the sensory fibers to the central tendon of the diaphragm or central part of the diaphragm. So the sensory distribution in the thorax, pericardium, mediastinal and the diaphragmatic pleura, and the central part of the diaphragm. In the abdomen, it gives the branches to the capsule of the liver and to the gallbladder. Liver and the gallbladder. So phrenic nerve, what should you know about it? Nerve roots. Root value, C3, 4, and 5. Course, in the neck, in the thorax, in the neck, in front of the scalenus anterior, in the thorax, superior mediastinum, and the middle mediastinum. Okay, in the thorax, the right phrenic nerve takes the venous side. On the right side of the right brachiocephalic vein, superior vena cava, right atrium, and inferior vena cava. The left phrenic nerve takes the arterial side between the left common carotid, left subclavian, on the left side of the left ventricle and the pericardium. Distribution, motor and sensory. Motor to the diaphragm, sensory in the thorax and in the abdomen. In the thorax, pericardium, mediastinal and the diaphragmatic pleura and central part of the diaphragm. In the abdomen, liver and the gallbladder. Now quiz yourself. Which one is longer than the other? Is it the right phrenic nerve or the left phrenic nerve? Of course, the left phrenic nerve is longer than the right because the right capsule of the diaphragm is higher than the left, and also the right phrenic nerve takes a straight course vertically downward, unlike the left phrenic nerve, which has a curved course. What is the clinical significance of the abdominal branches? It supplies the gallbladder and the liver. So in cholecystitis and in enlargement of the liver, the patient feels pain at the right shoulder. This is the referred pain because right shoulder, the dermatome of the shoulder is C4, same dermatome as the phrenic nerve. Where do you find the phrenic nerve in the neck in front of the scalenus anterior? What is the root value of the phrenic nerve? C3, 4, and 5. What is the relation of the phrenic nerve to the root of the lung? It runs in front, anterior to the root of the lung. In which mediastinum lies the phrenic nerve? In the superior mediastinum and in the middle mediastinum. Thoracic duct. What should you know about the thoracic duct? You should know the origin, termination, course, and the tributaries. So the beginning, it begins at the cisterna chyli or chyli. Cisterna chyli is a cyst in the upper part of the abdomen, and this cisterna chyli or cisterna chyli drains the abdomen and the two lower limbs. The termination, it terminates at the left venous angle, and this left venous angle is at the junction of the left internal jugular vein and the left subclavian vein, so it actually terminates or opens at the beginning of the left brachiocephalic vein. Then the course, it enters the abdomen through the aortic it enters the thorax through the aortic opening of the diaphragm. It ascends in the posterior mediastinum between the aorta and the azygous vein behind the esophagus. At T5, it curves from right to left. It ascends in the posterior mediastinum and in the superior mediastinum. Then tributaries in the abdomen, okay, cisterna chyli or cisterna chyli, and then left jugular lymph trunk, left subclavian lymph trunk, and left mediastinal lymph trunk. Left jugular lymph trunk drains the left half of the head and neck. Left subclavian lymph trunk drains the left upper limb. And left mediastinal lymph trunk drains the left half of the thorax. So thoracic duct begins at the cisterna chyli in the abdomen. It enters the thorax through the aortic opening of the diaphragm. It ascends in the posterior mediastinum and in the superior mediastinum. In the posterior mediastinum, it lies behind the esophagus between the descending aorta and the azygous vein. Termination in the left venous angle, it terminates at the beginning of the left brachiocephalic vein. It has four tributaries: cisterna chyli, left jugular lymph trunk, left subclavian lymph trunk, and left mediastinal lymph trunk. So actually, the thoracic duct drains all the body except three parts: right half of the thorax, right half of the head and neck, and right upper limb. These structures, these three parts, drain into the right lymphatic duct. Then we'll talk about the sympathetic chain. This is the sympathetic chain. We'll talk about the formation. It is formed by 11 to 12 ganglia. Okay, from 1 to 11 or 1 to 12. 11 to 12, because actually, number 1, the first thoracic ganglion, might fuse with the lower cervical one to form stellate ganglion. Okay, so formation 11 or 12 ganglia. It enters the thorax in front of the neck of the first rib. Here, in front of the neck of the first rib, it lies in front of the heads of the rib, of the ribs. It enters the abdomen behind the medial arcuate ligament, and then we'll talk about the branches. It gives the communicating branches with the spinal nerves. It gives thoracic splanchnic branches and abdominal splanchnic branches. Again, sympathetic chain formed of 11 to 12 ganglia, because the first one might fuse with the lower cervical ganglion to form stellate ganglion, enters the thorax in front of the neck of the first rib, leaves the thorax behind the medial arcuate ligament, it lies in front of the heads of the ribs. It gives communicating branches with the spinal nerves, gray and white rami communicants. It gives the thoracic splanchnic nerves to the thoracic viscera and the abdominal splanchnic nerves to the abdominal viscera. So what are the thoracic and the abdominal splanchnic nerves? These are the ganglia from 1 to 12 or from 1 to 11. Okay, so we have 4 thoracic splanchnic nerves and 3 abdominal splanchnic nerves. The thoracic splanchnic nerves arise from the upper 5 ganglia, from 1 to 5. These splanchnic branches from the first 5 thoracic ganglia are distributed to 4 structures. Cardiac branches to the cardiac plexuses. Pulmonary branches to the pulmonary plexuses anterior and posterior. Vascular branches around the blood vessels. And the esophageal branches to the esophageal plexus. So the thoracic splanchnic nerves, cardiac, pulmonary, vascular, and esophageal. The 3 abdominal splanchnic, greater splanchnic nerve, lesser splanchnic nerve, and the lowest splanchnic nerve. Greater splanchnic nerve to the foregut arises from number 5 to number 9 ganglia. And then the lesser splanchnic nerve to the midgut arises from 9 and 10 ganglia. And then lowest splanchnic nerve to the kidney, it arises from the last one, from number 12. Now let us talk about the aorta. Aorta, talk about the divisions, divided by the level of the sternal angle into 3 parts: ascending aorta, arch of the aorta, and descending aorta. The ascending aorta has only 2 branches, right and left coronary arteries. The arch of the aorta, this is the arch of the aorta, let us put the sternal angle, level of the sternal angle. So the beginning and the termination is at the level of the sternal angle. Continuation of the ascending aorta at the level of the sternal angle, it ends opposite the level of the sternal angle to continue as the descending aorta. It gives the 3 branches: brachiocephalic artery, left common carotid artery, and left subclavian artery. The brachiocephalic artery gives right common carotid and right subclavian arteries. Then the descending thoracic aorta, let us put the level of the sternal angle. Okay, so it begins at the level of the sternal angle, continuation of the arch, termination, it enters the abdomen through the aortic opening of the diaphragm opposite T12. And then the course, it descends in the posterior mediastinum behind the esophagus, and it gives the branches to everything in the thorax. So what are the branches of the descending thoracic aorta? Everything. Okay, start by the posterior intercostal arteries. Posterior intercostal arteries from number 3 to number 11, because the first 2 arise from the superior intercostal artery from the costo-cervical trunk. Okay, and then subcostal artery. It gives the branches to the left lung and left bronchus, 2 left bronchial arteries. Everything in the thorax, pericardial branches, esophageal branches, and the mediastinal branches. It gives also superior phrenic artery to the upper surface of the diaphragm. So branches, posterior intercostal arteries from number 3 to number 11, subcostal artery, 2 left bronchial arteries, pericardial, esophageal, mediastinal, and superior phrenic artery. And finally, superior vena cava. We'll talk about the formation of superior vena cava, termination, and the tributaries. Formation by the union of two brachiocephalic veins opposite the right first costal cartilage. Termination into the right atrium opposite the right third costal cartilage. It has only one tributary, a zygous vein opposite the right second costal cartilage. So remember, it begins opposite the first costal cartilage. It receives the zygous vein opposite the second. It terminates opposite the third costal cartilage. One, two, three. One is the origin, one costal cartilage, first costal cartilage, origin. Second costal cartilage, azygous veins enters the superior vena cava. Third costal cartilage, termination into the right atrium. And thank you very much. Best wishes and good luck.